having chronic pancreatitis.
Okay, same story.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
There, in fact, it is more indicated not to do a alcohol block.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So the message so far has been that we can try. Basically, it's a very severe incapacitating pain, so we have to give some kind of pain relief. Would you like to give apart from tramadol? Would you like to give stronger analgesics like morphine to this patient?
Yes.
Chronic pancreatitis.
Sometimes they come into severe pain, and you have to use opioids. But counseling is again required. So sure. If the patient goes into remission and he continues morphine, then he will go into addiction. So family
sir,
should be counseled, patient should be counseled, then he should remain under your care continuously. So under physician care, addiction is not a problem. Problem occurs when the patient goes on his own, and you are losing the follow up, and patient continues morphine from somewhere. So those type of.
So can we say, sir, the take-home message should be that morphine is related to the pain intensity and not life expectancy?
Yes, of course. These patients are going to live anyway.
Okay, in this patient, actually, finally the patient was affording. Like Dr. Sakore keeps reminding me. And we considered the option of doing spinal cord stimulation in this patient. It was a... There are very few references for this, but for... Not for chronic pancreatitis, but for visceral pain blocks, IBS and all, there are references where spinal cord stimulation was tried. In this patient also, we had this spinal cord stimulator IPG implanted. Patient responded very well to it. He came off fortepine, to which he had become addicted during the course of his treatment. So yeah, spinal cord stimulation for non-specific visceral neuropathic pain also helps. In some of these situations. Coming to the recommendation, by various bodies have given recommendations for management of chronic pancreatitis. In that, paracetamol wins the case because paracetamol should be used as the first line of treatment. NSAIDs off and on can be given for a short duration of time for acute on chronic type of pain. The recommendation is 1B. As a second step, tramadol can be recommended. And however, there seem to be many societies have come up with their own protocols, so the gradation keeps differing. But yes, tramadol seems to be another drug everybody seems to be attending to. Antioxidants have been shown to have long-term mild pain reduction. The level of evidence is 1B. And effectiveness of treatment with pancreatic enzymes has not been conclusively proven. However, there is a level of evidence of 1A from various other bodies. Coming to case 3, the patient has been referred. Yeah.
I would like to know what is the evidence of using spinal cord stimulator in chronic pancreatitis patient. If any of you can please enlighten the crowd. Spinal cord stimulator in a chronic pancreatitis patient.
There is no level 1 or level 2.
There is no evidence right now.
There are
level very 1
few
or level
case
2.
Reports.
There are no randomized trials.
No.
So I think
there are case reports
when,
only.
When such
case
a panel discussion
is no
going
documented
on,
evidence.
And a crowd is here, where there is a mix and match, there are a few absolutely new entrants, they will take a message that, well, this is a big gun, shoot it, and patient is fine.
No, no, no.
Absolutely
so please,
not.
Please
I
consider
said
that this is
no,
not
no, no,
that
no.
line of treatment.
Yes.
Probably they got a result, that is luck.
Absolutely,
a case report.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's what I mentioned in the recommendations. There is absolutely no recommendation. So evidence does not back this at all. In
she told about that, doctor.
I said that.
She told that there is no recommendation.
Yeah, this is what was tried and patient got relief, but no, absolutely, you are absolutely on dot. There is no recommendation like I mentioned in my table of recommendations. In case 3, this patient was referred from medicine department to the pain clinic. Patient known case of HIV on ARV. Complaints of burning pain in both feet since 4 months. Chronic intolerance to medications. History of nausea, vomiting, GI complaints, edema over both lower limbs, and no other comorbid illnesses. CD4 cell count was 180 cells. History of alcohol intake. Probable diagnosis of DSP was made. DSP in this case is distal symmetric polyneuropathy. I would like to ask Dr. Mayank Chansoria because he has managed this case.
Thank you, ma'am. I'd like to discuss this case because it's one of the most difficult cases which I faced and it really gave me a lot of shivers. and I want you in front of so many seniors that so we discuss it and so that we come up a more good approach to these kind of patients. Actually, this type of patient was referred to me in my pain clinic with all these features. He was having a distal symmetric polyneuropathy, and the main complaint was that he's having severe burning pain in both the feet, to the extent that that patient was not sleeping in nights and continuously rubbing cold ice and cold water to his feet. And apart from that, the relatives gave a very prominent complaint that don't give any strong medications to my patient. He's not tolerating any medications. So please be careful while prescribing medications. So apart from the history, it was evident that as peripheral, the most common neurological complication in HIV patients is peripheral neuropathy. So it was the first probable diagnosis which came to my mind. And from the relative's perspective, I started this patient on low-dose simple paracetamol and gabapentin. Came to me and told me ki your medications are not working. The patient is not having any pain relief. Apart from that, he's having severe nausea, severe vomiting, GI complaints are not ending up, and frequent pedal edemas are coming up. And so we told you earlier, please stop these medications. So I told him, okay, we'll try to change it. And I reduced the dose of paracetamol and added a bit of tramadol and changed from gabapentin to nortriptyline, and that too half dose in the night. Again, after a week or so, the relatives called me up and told me, sir, we have told you not to prescribe strong medications. The patient is not well at all. He's drowsy. His constipation is so severe that we are getting him admitted. And we told you and not, you didn't listen to us. And we'll be going to the superintendent. So ultimately, this patient, discussed this case with one of my neurophysician friend and asked him, you just have a look at this patient and see something I'm missing or not. So he examined, get a nerve conduction test, which
but
are all...
Can we stick to
representative
rather than...
So ultimately, after getting involvement of so many faculties, it was evident that the autonomic component was a very major factor in this patient, apart from the peripheral neuropathy, and all these complaints were due to autonomic component and ultimately autonomic neuropathy as frequently seen in diabetic patients, which I was missing up because I was having no idea that I should go in for this. And ultimately, apart from the basic medical management, a symptom specific management was started in discussion with the other faculties that the patient should be told to take a lot of fluids, don't indulge in frequent position changing, he might have syncopal attacks, take routine fiber diet, don't take a lot of meal at the one time. And he was referred to a physiotherapist so that he can get compression bandaging and all for the edema and a continuous laxative he was put on. And after 2 months of this treatment, he's not absolutely all right, but at least he's not complaining.
So if we say this patient basically had HIV related problems of neuropathy. So what would be the general guidelines, sir? Would you like to say or any of the others?
It is a neuropathic pain. So guidelines are neuropathic pain. So this patient, the first drug should have been duloxetine, 20 milligram BD. You start with duloxetine, that is the, I think, most researched drug, and the recommendations are about that. And then if you duloxetine doesn't give the relief, then add a small amount of nortriptyline or amitriptyline, like 10 milligram. If it doesn't give good relief, then you have to add the steroids. So triple therapy, you can start. So that is the usual guideline. And then you have to escalate the doses as the analgesia improves or side effects occur. So basically, these are the three drugs. That is the guideline.
What I have learned, ma'am, from this case is that apart from medications and interventions, sometimes you need a multimodal approach.
Yes.
Involve other faculties, get involved in proper counseling of the patients, and sometimes symptom-specific management can be of great help.
Absolutely. So just to sum up.
We are missing on use of methylcobalamin. I mean, you said you started gabapentin. It was giving trouble, so you shifted to nortriptyline. Instead, what I would have done is added pregabalin instead of gabapentin of the same group.
You're absolutely right, sir.
Please listen to me.
Methylcobalamin.
And then use, Prilogic or any Lyrica with meganeuron, OD plus amitriptyline or nortriptyline. This three combination, or as sir said, duloxetine when you're using, then use methylcobalamin, which is missing key in this, right?
Actually,
you're right, sir, but actually I would like to add something. He's already as an alcoholic, so maybe thiamine deficiency would have been a factor. What we can think of about, and
about
the patient while being in,
wherein we always use methylcobalamin.
It's what I'm telling,
prescription
in the medicine department, that patient was receiving IM injections of multivitamins since last 2 to 3 months. He had already received everything.
Basically, I agree with Dr. Chansoria. See, in HIV, the traditional medicines do not work. Actually, it has been recommended. No, traditional anti neuropathic.
What is the fun not giving methylcobalamin?
No, there is no fun.
I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm telling he had already received a lot of
everything. He had received
everything.
It doesn't work. Because in HIV, see, we are not discussing one particular case. This is an example, and then we are discussing various options, what could be done. So in HIV, the traditional neuropathic medication doesn't work. So what works, we don't know, but what doesn't work, we know. Yes. 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 Now the first line of treatment was like what has been done already. So you have got, would you like to sum up or you want me to sum up? So anticonvulsant and neuropathic drugs, they were given as a first line of treatment. All the traditionally used drug, right up to the maximum dosages, what they can be recommended and given to the patient. If they do not work, then in that case, I guess it is open, like whatever you want to try, which is not is not backed by evidence, but has been shown by case reports to give relief. We are discussing basically very difficult cases, so there are no protocols available. So depending upon your
actually
local
neuropathy
conditions,
in these HIV patients, it is due to disease per se as such, or sometimes antiretroviral therapy also. And we don't have a lot of exposure to these antiretroviral therapies. We have to depend on our medicine or an HIV specialist. So it depends on the center where you are working, actually.
So,
we went through the literature for some of the references, like what to do in HIV cases, and abroad it seems that cannabis and capsaicin 8% dermal patches have been used, but they are still in the study phase. They are not commercially available yet. Cannabis is available in UK, but I don't think anybody, even at Tata, do they have cannabis available or any of this?
Cannabis is available in any corner of the street in India. Cannabinoids are not available. Cannabinoids are not available for medicinal use, and soon they will be marketed, but cannabis is available, and that is why a lot of debate is going on whether to use medical marijuana for neuropathic pain. So there was a big debate in World Congress of Neuropathic Pain, medical marijuana, pro and con debate. So that's it.
So I guess like the local Panwala, we will have cannabis along with the meow meow, what seems to be going on right now.
Yes, but it's a very dicey situation for a doctor that he is prescribing cannabis, and then patient can go ori, and he starts getting addicted to that.
So in HIV, I think, do you think, sir, there is any role for lignocaine infusions or ketamine infusions in this case?
Certainly. If the patient comes on acute severe pain in the casualty, in the midnight, you cannot give just morphine and expect pain relief in this patient. You have to use lignocaine. Certainly it will work.
What would be the dose range, sir, so that people will know?
So you have to use 1 milligram per kg body weight as a bolus. And then you can go for 0.2 to 0.5 milligram per kg body weight of lignocaine every hour. And for under ECG monitoring and your recovery, you can give for 4 hours. And some patient say there is no pain now. After 1 hour, they say that this was never, I was in such a painless state ever in my life. So that is it. And ketamine also gives very relief. And ketamine sometimes give pain relief once one infusion works for 7 days also. So if you give weekly, can ketamine. Yeah.
Mike.
Yes. Okay. Due to
Dr. Singh, do
Dr.
you want
Madhuri,
to add something?
Dr. Madhuri, due to paucity of
time, my flight. Thank you so much.
So, yeah, thank you.
We really appreciate and thanks very much for participating.
Thank
here.
You, sir.
Okay, we come to the last case. Morbidly obese patient, 45-year-old lady, was taken for open cholecystectomy. I think it should be open laparotomy or whatever. The lab reports were all normal, and we wanted to do something about how will you plan postoperative analgesia. Dr. Ninave, could you tell us something about this?
Thank you to the organizers for giving me this opportunity. In this case, patient is morbidly obese. The BMI is around 40. So in this patient, there are postoperative risk factors like comorbid conditions, and we have to avoid the respiratory depression in the postoperative period by avoiding the analgesics which are causing the respiratory depressions. So if we are giving this patient with intramuscular or IV medications like fentanyl or intramuscular or drips, there are possibility of having a depression. So avoid such problems to help the patient for early recovery. We are in our centers are practicing the epidural analgesia. And with the low dose of bupivacaine and with various adjuvants, and the most commonly we are using clonidine in this.
What would be the dose for various things? For postoperative analgesia by continuous infusion?
Yes,
continuous. Or you are giving doses?
Actually, we are practicing a SOS. Okay. As per the patient's demand, we are practicing. Before shifting the patients, we are giving us top-up dose with low dose of bupivacaine 0.06% along with the clonidine 30 to 45 mics. And later on in the recovery or the 60
okay, it seems I'm not very comfortable with this without any evidence to back up, but from the audience and from the expert, it seems that the use of buprenorphine in spinal has been quite prevalent. And people have tried it right from 50 milligrams to 100 mics with successfully getting the results. However, in an obese patient.
Morphine, you can use it, but as we have discussed, it is a morbidly obese patient, and you know you can have a pretty difficult respiratory depression, and that could be pretty hard to manage, or you can get into complications. So it's up to you whether you are confident using it or not.
Basically, we would try to avoid opiates in this case, and or at least reduce the dosage to avoid, because actually, in India, we don't use morphine for postoperative analgesia so commonly. In cardiac centers, some of the cardiac centers they are using, but general doctors do not have access to injection morphine so readily.
Fentanyl
in many of the
can
institutes.
Also be used as an adjuvant along with.
In
yes.
Central India, it's not easily available,
not
actually.
Available.
It's not.
I have given both of them only with morphine. When I was another that I don't know.
Yeah.
And even buprenorphine also we use commonly. But I have never used my three
Yes, of course, it's a gold standard, so I agree with you. And abroad, they are using morphine for even PCA pumps and everything without any side effects. Yes, so I think it all depends on the experience. Yes. What, 1 milligram morphine intrathecally?
You are right. We can give for laparoscopic procedure, like it is good. So why to put catheter? Or if you are not putting the catheter, we can give single shot epidural.
Basically, there the pain levels are much less anyway in laparoscopy. Whenever the abdomen is open, that is a win.
Yes, yes. Intraoperative it will be used. Intraoperatively, we can give the high dose of local anesthetic agent and post-operatively.
We can sum up it that we can use intrathecal or epidural according to the physician's preference, and but we should keep in mind the complications.
These are the general things. Try to reduce the level of opioid dosages as far as possible, because we don't want to avoid the sleep apnea syndrome for which morbidly obese patients might come. So. Yes, tap lock is another one. Yes, absolutely, absolutely correct. Yes. But I think in an obese patient, you will have to do it under sonographic guidance or something, because how will you... Yeah. Yeah, yeah, because without guidance, then we will not know where. So if you have guidance available, then tap lock is definitely an alternative in these cases. I would like to sum up, because I'm sure people are getting hunger pangs and hunger pains now. So I thank all my panelists for bearing with me and coming with such excellent preparation. Thank you very much. I thank the audience.
Madam. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
initially he managed pain center in the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and then he started a pain center, Delhi Pain Management Center, in Safdarjung. And now he has three centers in Delhi NCR area. This is my center, IPS India. This I started in 2011 after Dr. Kumar passed away. So I took all the instruments and I started the center. All the most of the corporate hospitals in northern part, especially in the Delhi NCR area, they have now different pain department, pain specialty departments. Like in Fortis Hospital, Fortis Noida, we have with us Dr. Shiv Kumar. So he's looking after the pain center in Fortis Noida. Medanta Medicity, Dr. Rajkumar is there. He is in charge of the pain center in Medanta Medicity. Artemis Hospital, Dr. Anshu, he is the pain in charge. So Dr. Malvinder Sahi, he is sitting here. He is in charge of the pain center in Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Institute. So that way, we have like on almost all the corporate hospitals, we have a pain center, now established pain centers there. In other parts, apart from the Delhi NCR area, we other have like BHU, Banaras Hindu University, where we have started a 1 year post PDCC, postdoctoral certificate courses. So there are two centers in northern India. One is BHU and another is SGPGI. So these are the two centers who are holding this 1 year PDCC courses. Also, we have Postgraduate Institute Chandigarh, where Dr. Batra is there. He's also running a pain center there, and he's also doing some teaching programs there. Choithram Hospital, where our Organization Secretary of the ISSP 2015-2016, he's in charge of this pain center. So I cannot cover everything. So that was just an overview of the pain center which we are running in the northern part of India. Dr. Gaurav is also here. He's running a pain center in Jaipur. So almost everybody is doing now good work in pain management. So before I start the scientific session, I just wanted to take up two cases, interesting cases. So this will develop some interest in the diagnostic dilemma. So this was a patient, these are the actual patients and actual scenarios. So this was a patient who came to me, 70-year-old male, obese patient, back pain, which was more on the right side than left side, radiation to right thigh, at times it was going up to the right leg also. Complaints were tossing on chair. And the first investigation which was ordered for him was MRI of the left spine. And now you can see that was the MRI. That was the MRI picture of this patient. Multiple level disdenation, multiple level prolapse. Diagnosis was given, spinal canal stenosis, lumbar canal stenosis. So he was advised surgery, multiple level surgery and fixation surgery. So he was a brigadier, ex-army officer who had come from US. So he came to me and he showed me the MRI. So I examined him and I said, sir, I don't think your pain is coming from this part. I examined him, I found that SI joint was tender. And another interesting history he gave is, he's been walking 4 to 5 kilometers every day. And there's no numbness, there's no heaviness. But MRI picture is showing something different. So when I examined him, I found that his SI joint was tender and his symptoms are also matching with sacroiliitis. So when I explained him about the sacroiliitis, that sir, you are not suffering from this pain, you are suffering from sacroiliitis. So he got annoyed. He got annoyed because he said, I come from US, I visited around 5-6 hospitals. He named all the big hospitals. And he said, Kina, I've been advised surgery. Somebody said this fixation surgery, we'll do this thing, we'll do that thing. Can you do something without surgery? Because he heard that I'm doing some intervention procedure. So doc, can you do something? Intervention, can you do without surgery? Because now you have come with some other diagnosis. So he got annoyed and he went back. But next week he came back. And the first thing what he said is, doc, you are the first person who has examined me. Wherever I have been to other places, everybody is looking at my MRI and they're advising me this surgery, that surgery, different type of surgeries. So clinical examination. So did a SI joint block. Wonderful block. He had a very good pain relief, 70-80% with pain relief within a week. So he was very, very happy. And I still remember him because he still keeps sending patients from US to me. That is. Okay, so another case. Now see this. Another very interesting thing. So somebody posted in a pain group. So we have a lot of groups nowadays. WhatsApp group, Facebook groups, a lot of groups are there. So somebody posted this picture in one of the group. And he wrote just, please suggest. So what was the reaction? There were 36 comments on this MRI. 36 comments, different comments, with all sorts of diagnosis. And 11 procedures were advised. Somebody suggested do this, somebody suggested try this, somebody suggested try this. Even somebody suggested do vertebroplasty, because there was some, this thing, a small node is there. So somebody suggested even vertebroplasty also. So this, we are facing all this kind of thing. So just by looking at MRI, people have started advising, try this. Why we should try? This is a patient, he's not a guinea pig. So without knowing the history, without examining the patient, everybody starts advising by just looking at the MRIs. So that is very wrong. So with these two cases in background, we'll start our scientific session. So we have our panelists, we have our chairpersons. So I'll call upon Dr. Malvinder Sahi. He is a consultant in charge of Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Hospital. Dr. Kritika Doshi, she is in Jaipur, Jupiter Hospital. She's a consultant in charge in Jupiter Hospital and Bethany Hospital. And she's also the joint secretary of ISSV Mumbai branch. Okay. And she's also the program commission chairperson of AMC. Can you just tell me about AMC, what is it?
Association of Medical Consultants.
Yes, Association of Medical Consultants. She's a program commission chairperson for that. We have Dr. Sarita Singh. She is the pain charge and research professor in the Department of Anesthesiology, KGMC, Lucknow. We have Dr. Arif Hossain. He is a consultant in charge. He is practicing in Srinagar. And who else is there? Yeah, Dr. Rajkumar. He is one of the panelists. He is a consultant in charge of pain department in Medanta Medicity. So we'll start our panel discussion after the cases, after the three lectures. So we are just changing the sequence because Dr. Shiv, he has to catch his flight. So we'll be starting with Dr. Shiv Kumar. So he'll be talking about the quantitative sensory testing, sensory motor testing in pain management.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Pankaj Range, for introduction. So we'll be talking about quantitative sensory testing in assessing neuropathic pain. Actually, neuropathic pain is a very, very big topic, and we know since yesterday we are talking about, you know, different modalities to diagnose. We already had some views from Dr. Surange regarding the assessment of patients. Basically means sign and symptoms tells, okay, whether it's neuropathic kind of pain, somatic pain, visceral pain, or bony pain, basically, but whether it is true or not, right? Everything, whatever we are seeing through our eyes, that is basically perceptual. Whatever behind the, exactly diagnosing the mechanism of neuropathic pain, that is entirely different. Till now, maybe we can say till 2006, there are a lot of articles which says, okay, neuropathic pain can be categorized because of depending upon the etiology, depending upon the treatment response. But since 2006 onwards, basically some research is going on that tells, okay, the treatment of neuropathic pain should be basically based on the mechanism rather than the etiology. So the current problem is definitely the pain diagnosis. We usually treat the sign and symptoms. And usually the patients with some neuropathic pain, they don't have purely neuropathic pain. They usually have some sort of mixed pain, some component of somatic, visceral, or some component of somatic plus neuropathic component. So maybe we can say 70 to 80% patients have this kind of presentation. ISP in 2008 gave the definition of neuropathic pain means as a consequence of direct injury to the nerve or any dysfunction related with the somatosensory system. So, but this definition is still basically being evaluated further, and some validation data basically is going on through basically some in research is going on in UK, and some research is going on in Germany, and there is one group in UK. They are doing a lot of research on these quantitative sensory testing, means the mechanism behind the neuropathic pain. So the evidence of structural damage, there is limited information about the mechanism. Everybody is talking about the etiology and treating the symptoms, but nobody talk about the mechanism. This is very common scenario, I'll tell you. Basically, we know that trigeminal neuralgia is neuropathic pain, right? It's sharp shooting, knife poking kind of sensations. But why only carmazepine works there? Why don't we give pregabalin or gabapentin as a first choice? Because most of the time we see, like, you know, patients with low back pain have some sort of radicular symptoms, that is some neuropathic component, radiculitis. We usually give them either tricyclic antidepressants or anticonvulsants, but we don't give them carmazepine as our first choice. So why only in trigeminal neuralgia? It's very, very, you know, some sort of, we can say that hidden information is there whenever we talk about the mechanism behind any kind of neuropathic pain. So that there are, I have quoted 4 or 5 references, and they have very excellent information about the mechanism. So this was one of the very good article in 2011. This diagrammatic representations related with the disease process, that is any kind of nerve injury, with mechanism of the neuropathic pain as well as the symptoms and ultimately leading to the pain syndrome. So whatever basically we are treating is a disease process or some disease modifying agents in some kind of situations, maybe herpetic infections or post-herpetic neuralgia kind of situations, we usually give antiviral treatment. But the real situation, the real problem comes whenever we talk about the mechanism. So how to measure? The measurement, we usually do the sign and symptoms of the patients, and ultimately that leads to, there was one study in 2006 by Albert et al. They say that more than 50% of patients have, less than 50% of pain relief if we treat depending on the sign and symptoms basis. So there are different methods to identifying the mechanism of pain in humans. One diagnostic test to identify peripheral generators, like skin biopsy for small fibers, neuropathy. Some pharmacological approaches are there. Some genetic markers, brain imaging, that is functional magnetic resonance imaging. Distinct symptoms clusters in patients with the same diagnosis. We usually make the differential diagnosis. Suppose if the patient have trigeminal neuralgia, neuropathic pain, then we can categorize maybe cluster headache, some Shunt syndrome, some trigeminal autonomic neuropathic syndrome. So, but quantitative sensory testing is one of the very important aspect regarding the diagnosis of any neuropathic pain. So what it is? The assessment of perceptual and of physiological responses to systematically applied and quantifiable sensory stimuli for the purpose of characterizing somatosensory function or dysfunction. It's a, some sort of complex definition. I'll try myself best that we can understand how it is being done. So I was talking about the DFNS, the German Research Network on Neuropathic Pain. They developed a standardized quantitative sensory testing battery. That battery consists of 7 items, and that measures the 13 different subcategories. So this battery includes the assessment of detection threshold for thermal and mechanical stimuli. It's very, 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 very basic. But the real problem comes with the assessment part. So if we talk about anything, do we have anything in India regarding, if we talk about, if we want to detect the thermal and mechanical stimuli or some sort of pain perception threshold, some dynamic allodynia receptor sensitivity, do we have? I'm not sure whether we do any kind of research work if we talk about the neuropathic pain in India. So the implemented within the entire DFNS using the standardized instruction and investigator training. Usually this DFNS society, they usually train the particular selected candidates for 1 year training for assessing this neuropathic pain. And after that assessment, they are eligible to do some mechanism of neuropathic pain study. So quantitative sensory testing assess the function of small and large afferent fibers. So I will talk about the 13 different thermal and mechanical tests. So these are some of them, like CDT, we talk about the thermal detections. We talk about the paradoxical heat sensations using different kind of cold and warm stimuli. Thermal pain threshold for cold, that is CPT or HPT, hot stimuli perception. Then we talk about the mechanical detection threshold for touch, that is MDT or vibration, VDT. Then mechanical pain sensitivity and stimulus response for pinprick sensitivity, that is the mechanical pain sensitivity. So these are different 13 valid, we can say, markers which denotes. They have, they have this programming system. So when they do some calculations and fill out this, like what is the patient's mechanical sensitivity, perception threshold, or some DMA, some kind of phenomena, like how they respond to different kind of modality. So ultimately, they give certain scoring system, and that scoring system is, you can categorize it whenever we control it with the control, right? Some healthy individuals. So if we talk about, having some control group, so that is scored as JET system. So when we talk about the JET, can be positive or that JET can be negative. So JET positive means some function is gaining. JET negative means some function is lost. So gain of function and the loss of function is very, very important, positive and negative phenomena that is being assessed through all these 13 parameters. Some mechanical hyperalgesia is indicated if gain of function was present in case of allodynia, mechanical perception threshold, pressure perception threshold, or mechanical pain sensitivity. And so this was, I was talking about Z score above and below. So gain of functions and loss of function as compared to different things. So this is very simplified form of this quantitative sensory testing. Means if we talk about chemical pain modalities, then we have, what measures we have? We do like EEG, functional MRI study, or the positron imaging emission test. If we do ischemic, then conditional pain modulation is one important thing. Mechanical, then temporal summation. Immersion, thermal, that is heat and cold, then supra threshold scaling, that is the VAS scoring and the numerical rating scale. If we talk about electrical, then pain threshold is one important thing. So what mechanism related questions can QST address? What is the validity? Like how valid it is to conduct this quantitative sensory testing for any particular patient? So basically it tells about 4 things, like does a patient or group of patients show changes in QST responses? Means it can be regional or some generalized changes. Stimulus modality, what is the modality of stimulus, whether it can be either cold induced, heat induced, or some thermal or non-thermal modality. Temporal summation or conditioned pain modulation phenomena. The second thing, can patients be subgrouped based on their QHT responses? means if it comes in the positive JADE scoring system, it can come in the negative JADE scoring system. So whether we can categorize according to the JADE score system, do pre-treatment QST responses predict treatment outcome? Okay, I'm giving gabapentin to any low back pain. What is the predictability? How can I predict that the patient is going to have good relief or not? If the patient, suppose there was one study in which there was one case report of spinal cord injury, I was going to mention that also. The spinal cord injury patients has two kind of pain, right and left side. The right side pain was some sort of central neuropathic pain, and the left side pain was differentiation pain. So two different kind of pain, the pain characteristic, that is the sign and symptoms of the patients, was very, very similar. That is pin pricking, poking, or some very, very neuropathic characteristics, sign and symptoms. But what exactly that basically the author gave one medicine, pregabalin, okay? Although we don't know the NNT for treating this kind of pain for pregabalin, but the author gave the pregabalin for that patient's, the patient's right side pain did improve, but the left side pain didn't improve, although the characteristics was same. So it means, suppose if the patient has two different kind of pain, right side and left side of pain, same symptoms means burning, some knife poking kind of sensation, doesn't mean that medicine is going to affect both, basically. So that is the important aspect, that do pre-treatment QST responses predict treatment outcome. And can treatment-induced effect, if we are giving carmazepine to trigeminal patients, if we give carmazepine to other neuropathic pain patients, whether it's going to affect, whether it's going to work or not? I'm sure most of us don't give carmazepine for low back pain, for knee kind of pain, right? But basically, here is the answer, that QST usually tells these kind of situations. So there was one study, actually the topic is very, very, we can say very, very recent, because a lot of studies being going on in Western countries. So this was one study in 2010, published in Pain Journal, that they treated osteoarthritis patients with severe clinical pain and mild to moderate clinical pain, depending upon less than six or more than six. So they showed that significant greater temporal summation of pressure pain was there. Okay, we can see in the diagrammatic representation, the topmost panel. The topmost panel is at the knee, and the below one is the tibialis anterior. So they said that, they concluded that osteoarthritis patients with severe pain tend to show greater temporal summation. So it means that does a patient or group of patients show changes in QST responses, means can be generalized or can be regional? So yes, the answer of this question, the first question was, yes, they do have this sort of temporal summation of pain. So depending upon that various 13 parameters, they do concluded that these patients did have purely neuropathic pain, and QST is one important thing that can define the particular type of treatment is going to affect that patients or not. Another study, endogenous pain modulations in IBS and TMD patients versus healthy control. So another very good study. So they concluded that control showed significant decrease in heat pain ratings when the contralateral foot was concurrently immersed in cold water. So basically, this also again tells the first question. This also explains the first question, whether it can be subgrouped as a temporal summations, whether we can conclude any sort of conclusion depending upon giving different kind of pain perception, or just to diagnose the neuropathic pain. The second question was, can patients be subgrouped based on their QST responses? Can we categorize them? Can we divide them? Can we do classification depending upon that? So one important study, cluster across multiple experimental pain measures, published in 2005. So you can see that the linear diagram, basically they have some sort of overlap. So they concluded that within a diagnostic group, different patterns of sensory abnormality can emerge. So some patients, usually most of the patients have you know, overlapping kind of pattern. So overlapping kind of pattern means then these patients, if we treat as purely neuropathic, if we give only one medicine, the chances of providing good relief for any kind of pain, mainly neuropathic pain, is around 25 to 30%. So because of this overlapping, so this was the landmark study in 2006, so done by Mayer et al. And they did define, they do concluded the first, the very first aspect as well as that, and they also concluded that across diagnostic groups, similar patients, pattern of sensory abnormalities are observed. So different, suppose low back pain, knee osteoarthritis pain, TM, temporomandibular disorders patients, some IBS patients, some trigeminal patient, cluster headache patients, but similar pattern of sensory abnormalities can be observed. So this was one important aspect. The third one was, do pre-treatment QST responses predict treatment outcome? This was, again, you know, duloxetine works very well for post-herpetic neuralgia, right? Post-herpetic neuralgia having a lot of neuropathic component, why not pregabalin or gabapentin? Basically, these are some of the studies which do say that if we are going to give particular medicine, okay, what is the reason why there is poor pain inhibitory function as compared to the other?
Dr. Rana, I'd like you to...
So the last one was, can treatment-induced effect on QST reflect changes in pain mechanism? Yes, the greater drug efficacy in this diabetic neuropathy, we do mention effect of duloxetine for diabetic neuropathy patients. So yes, they have greater drug efficacy if we talk about as compared to other. So this I was mentioning about that the patients with the spinal cord injury having different kind of pain, but the medicine doesn't improve the contralateral, that is differentiation pain, but definitely central sensitization pain do get better. So assessment of neuropathic pain, basically, I think we had another lecture. So to conclude my presentation, a single QST parameter can be used to identify different subgroup of neuropathic pain patients, so mainly characterized by ultramechanical pain sensitivity. And QST phenotypic characterizations, so basically working at the molecular level just to establish the normative data and disease-specific data. Okay, this medicine is going to treat for this patient, or the other medicine is not going to treat the same patients. QST may facilitate mechanism-based pain diagnosis, and definitely a lot of research is being going on for pain mechanism and the treatment outcome. Mainly we talk about the neuropathic pain. So thank you very much for your kind listening. This is International Neuropathic Pain Update. Dr. Sushma Bhatnagar is basically organizing secretary. I'm part of that scientific committee. So we are conducting this ISP neuropathic pain on 7th of November, and also conducting some essential pain management educations. Those who want to join the program, then they are welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rana, Dr. Rana, for a very nice and enlightening talk. We can have time for one or two questions from the audience. Any? What I understand from the visual, I think the machine is more complicated than a...
Yeah. Than a basically, light detector. We usually see the sign and symptoms only, but we never talk about the mechanism behind the neuropathic pain. So that is important, actually.
So how relevant they are these days?
Yeah. Some validation data is going on. That's why I spoke that this QST is being done after 2006, so it's very, very recent. There is as such no valid conclusive evidence that, but if we talk about, after going through all these literature, I came to conclusion maybe within five years, definitely it's going to matter a lot. Yeah,
for diagnosing them here, are we doing, what about your practice day to day, are you advising these tests to the patient, or are you doing these kind of assessments?
No, these are for just a gold standard data. We can't, do these examination on patients. But definitely, like I was talking about predicting the treatment and treatment-related outcome, that disease related outcome. Okay, if we are giving this medicine for this treatment, then it's going to be effective. If not, then so basically we can say some sort of evidence is being going on, so that you can have okay gabapentin for this treatment only, carmazepine for this treatment only. Like they are planning to can have this.
How much they are related with cost effective?
Cost effectiveness. See, I already spoken that in India we don't do any kind of this. This is actually molecular level work because they are talking about mechanism, right? So cost, I really don't know.
Any tests that you can do in the clinical setup for patients?
Yes, we can do. But again, you know,
no, so for the audience to know, how will you diagnose?
Yeah, suppose if you want to conduct the mechanical pressure perception threshold, right? So there are various methods that explains you can do some you can apply some sort of cotton. But you know, the sensitivity and the specificity is not too good, because if I apply my finger pressure to one particular patient, if you will apply, the pressure is going to be different. It can, so you know, it can't be same for person to person. What they are mentioning about doing this 7 battery test, they have actually this standardized protocol as well as the instruments, and that is not available in India. So they have very, very costly instruments there, which usually, you know, does all these mechanical perception thresholds. So they will use only this. So that has been standardized, definitely.
Thank you, Dr. Rana.
Thank you very much.
We'll call our next speaker, Dr. Gaurav Sharma, who is going to talk on EMG and nerve conduction velocity basics. He's an assistant professor of anesthesia at SMS, and he started the first pain clinic in Rajasthan in 2009 in the private sector.
So the topic is basics of EMG and NCV. Originally, this topic is to be taken by Dr. Vaibhav Bhola, and somehow he has some reason, and I have to prepare in rush. So I just I think I can justify the topic and satisfy you all. So it's a test which is not very commonly practiced by us, and mostly it is done by the neurologist and the rehab people. They are the most commonly done, and we usually go for the reports, and based on these reports, we go for the further planning about the management or about the any patient, any painful condition. So the purpose of this lecture is we should know when to order and when not to order, and what is the significance of these tests, because however, what whatever the knowledge we can gain, it is better, but most of the time it is done by some other faculty people. So EMG, electromyography, and nerve conduction studies, NCVs or NCS, these are the extension of physical examination. And these are not a replacement for the physical examination. These are only supportive things. And it is quantitates the nerve and or muscle injuries. So you can test the integrity of the nerve as well as muscle with these tests. And it provides useful data regarding nerve injuries. It can be site, type, severity, duration, and prognosis. These can be quantified by these studies. What are the importance of the electrodiagnostic studies? So you can diagnose the pathology, you can localize the pathology, whether it is there and assist in further testing, then you can go for some biopsy taking or imaging study or spinal fluid analysis or blood works. So these tests can guide you for the further management, and it has some prognostic value and research values. So what are the points to remember? They both assess the physiology of nerve as well as the muscles. And not all radiculopathies are structural. Neurological consultation is best obtained before the testing is ordered. I have already told you, neurology is they are the person who are regularly doing it, and they know how to do it. And if nerve conduction and EMG normal or non-contributory, justification for neurology consultation is greater than before testing. So it is a teamwork. You involve in your team a neurologist or rehab people are also doing very good in these fields. So what are the goals? Goals is to identify the localization of the disease and the severity. Localization can be due to the muscle, neuromuscular junction, nerves, and anterior horn. Then the fiber type you can identify, and then pathology and the temporal course. So when to order nerve conduction studies and EMG. So whenever the dilemma of the mononeuropathy multiplex, radiculopathy, plexopathy, anterior horn cell disorders, diffuse neuropathies, cranial neuropathies, neuromuscular junction disorders, and myopathy, so you have to go for these tests so that you can identify where the problem lies. And that is also very important when not to order these studies. There is CNS disorders, like patient is in stroke, CVA, encephalopathy, spinal cord injuries, multiple sclerosis, total body fatigue, fibromyalgia, joint pain, unexplained weakness without a neurological consultation, failed back, already patient has gone for multiple surgeries, or in a pace, or a replacement of neurological consultation. It is a very commonly abused test also. In our city, there are a lot of physical therapist, even a physiotherapist, and some nursing staff also, they are very fond of these tests. So what are the type of nerve conduction studies? First is sensory, and they can be antidromic, and typically commonly nerve examined is the sural, ulnar, medial, and occasionally radial and superficial peroneal nerves. What are the parameters they usually measured? Onset and peak latencies, these are very important. Conduction velocity, they are determined by velocity of very few fast fibers. Amplitude, it is determined by a number of large sensory fibers activated. So this is one example of normal median of sensory studies, where you can see the latencies, that's amplitude, and velocity, conduction velocity. Then motor nerve conduction parameters, what are they noted? Distal latency, amplitude, proximal conduction velocity. Distal latency is determined by conduction velocity of the nerve, neuromuscular junction, and muscle, because motor fiber, that constitutes a motor unit. Then amplitude, it is determined by the number of muscle fiber, how much muscle fiber are getting activated. And then proximal conduction velocity is determined by the conduction velocity of the fastest fiber. Motor nerve conduction. So vital part of this study is important the identifying the demyelination and compression. So you have to identify whether there is a demyelinating changes occurs and compression occurs, and that can be useful by these type of studies. And you need to do proximal and distal studies also to evaluate for the conduction velocity and conduction block and temporal dispersion. Commonly examined nerves are ulnar, median, peroneal, and tibial. Ulnar and median in upper limb and peroneal tibia in the lower limb. And radial and femoral, phrenic, spinal accessory, facial, these are the less commonly examined. It is the diagram which is showing how the nerve conduction goes into the nerve. Any pain fiber, skin stimulates, records spinal cord. This whole pathway is recorded in the below given the graph. So latency, then the amplitude is going on, then the conduction velocity, these all fibers you can see. A delta, A alpha, A beta, because motor fibers are A alpha and A beta, then the C fibers. So you can measure from A to C fibers. Then these are some other studies, orthodromic studies. This is the motor conduction studies. These are different type of studies. I just don't want to go into the details. This is just to enumerate how they are going. This is the latency period, then the amplitude. This is the distal stimulating points. Then this comes here, M waves. So nerve conduction velocity is derived from this formula, D1 minus D2 upon L1 minus L2. This is again a motor studies. And then comes for the peripheral neuropathies. There are different type of peripheral neuropathies, and you can identify and distinguish between different type of peripheral neuropathy by using this modality. This is the thing, this is the modalities diagnostic test which is useful for these type of neuropathies. Mononeuropathies, mononeuropathy multiplex, plexopathy and polyneuropathy. You can identify and distinguish all type of neuropathies. This is the nerve conduction, and then the other test is F wave and H reflex. These are also come into the these in studies. These are useful for identifying proximal segmental demyelination and can only be done when motor amplitude is more than 1 millivolt, and it is extremely height dependent. So this is the normal EMG. Now EMG is a method of testing both the physiological state and the anatomical integrity of lower motor neuron structure, their sensory component and some spinal and brainstem reflex pathway. So it is the whole channel which can be tested by doing these tests. And the lower motor neuron, you all know, that is composed of anterior horn cell, nerve root, plexus, peripheral nerve cells, neuromuscular junction and muscles. So the integrity of the whole system is checked with the EMG and NCV. And it is the evaluation of how it is doing. EMG, it is an evaluation of muscle function and indirectly nerve root and anterior horn cell by the needle insertion into the muscle. And it has started like that. You put a needle into the muscle. Then the evolution comes, and these F reaction, H reflex, and all these things, they come later on. The term become more inclusive one that includes nerve conduction velocity testing and F and H reflexes, cranial nerve reflexes, and a study of the neuromuscular junction. In electromyography, in techniques, what you do, needle is inserted into the muscle, needle should be disposable, single use, multiple muscle can be accessed for the examination and combination of the muscle tested, dependent upon the clinical questions, and level of discomfort is mild for the patient. What are the data you gathered with the study? The insertional activity, then spontaneous activity, motor unit configuration, motor unit recruitment, and interference pattern. These five things, they are gathered by this EMG. So what is the motor unit configuration? It is the single motor unit consists of motor axon and all its muscle fibers. The motor unit configuration has three components: amplitude, duration, and morphology. And muscle is voluntarily activated at different force level. When you apply different type of force, the reaction will be the different. And the needle recording properties enable assessment of single motor units. Then comes the recruitment, motor unit recruitment. It is a pattern of motor unit activation with increasing volitional activation. And then interference pattern, motor unit pattern with full voluntary activation. I know these are the terms which is not very relevant, and it is done by the specialist. It is just for the sake of, I'm not going into much detail, but just enumerating the things. So these are the some pictures like for the fibrillatory potential. These are sharp waves. These are the spontaneous activity, example of the spontaneous activity. Another example of spontaneous activity is the fasciculation potential. So this is a neurogenic motor activity, how it is look like in EMG. This motor unit changes, then then comes to the mononeuropathies. Commonly, carpal tunnel syndrome, tardy ulnar nerve palsy, these are the for the median and ulnar nerves, and then the peroneal palsy at the fibular head. So these tests are important in these. Whenever you get the patient of these diseases, you can go for confirming with the EMG and NCV. Just a case history of the one patient, that 63-year-old woman, numbness, tingling, and pain of entire hand in the last 4 months. It is so severe that he can awaken her at the night, and she cannot hold the objects in the right hand. And he's a worker in the factory, borderline diabetic patient. Examination, that periphery is slightly cold, and the entire right hand strength is power is normal, positive tunnel sign at the right wrist, and her reflexes are normal. So the carpal tunnel syndrome, everybody is very much aware about this. So there can be atrophy of this abductor pollicis brevis, and you can go with these tests. So how this is again a picture of this median nerve innervation of the hand and sensory loss, and the first picture is showing how the studies can be performed. These are the different sites where the you are electrodes, recording electrodes and sensing electrodes are you has to put there, and the stimulation site and the latency and amplitude, these all are the parameters how you perform these studies. It is just for enumeration. The median nerve, ulnar nerve, I already told that these are the common nerves. Then ulnar neuropathy, claw hand, you have, it's a, these things, these are confirmatory with these tests. Then peroneal, foot drop, sensory loss. Then it is length dependent motor and sensory polyneuropathy. Polyneuropathy and diabetic polyneuropathy, there you can identify a lot of type of neuropathies. It can be length dependent, it can be symmetrical, it can be pen and glove, it can be Stockings. And there are all types of neuropathy you can encounter in the diabetic neuropathy. So you, in that cases, it can be helpful that you can define it. So EMG and NCV, they are useful in the diagnosis of polyneuropathy and in determination whether a pathological process is axonal or demyelinating or both. A diagnosis of polyneuropathy is made when abnormal nerve conduction and EMG finding are bilateral and relatively symmetrical. So what are the findings which comes in the axonal neuropathy? In axonal neuropathy, there is sensory nerve action potential amplitude is always low and absent. And muscle action potential is also low or absent. But the latency for the sensory and motor is always normal. It is a very important point that distal latency is always normal, as well as the motor conduction velocity is also normal. So this is the important finding we should know about. Then plexopathy. Plexopathy is also nowadays very commonly encountered. It can be in the compression plexopathy, like in CABG. It can be Parsonage Turner syndrome, that inflammatory plexopathy. Then chemo or radio-induced radiation injury plexopathy. Trauma is very common. Road traffic accident, brachial plexus injury. Nowadays, the cases are increasing day by day. And it can be due to the traction, laceration, or some missile injuries. And in diabetic amyotrophy, it can be due to the ischemia around the plexus. Guillain-Barré is another example where it is useful to detect the conduction block. Then dermatomyositis, the EMG is useful because it affects the muscles. Myasthenia gravis, it is also very important. Then these are the findings in the normal and myasthenia gravis muscle. Repetitive nerve stimulations. Then these are Lambert-Eaton syndromes. So what to expect from EMG reports? So that should be a clinically and physiological relevant interpretation and diagnosis there, and outline of localization, severity, and acuity of the process, and notation of other diagnoses that are detected or excluded, and explanation of any technical problem. So it is very important to communicate when you order an EMG or NCV to the neurologist or the physiatrist who are doing the test that these are the clinical findings, and I want to clear my doubt that this is the possible pain generator or this is the culprit thing. So you have to given me the right direction so that I can go for the further management. The electrodiagnostic studies are a supplement, not a replacement, for the history and the physical examination. So it's history and physical examination are the very important thing. You do not replace these things with the clinical tests or these the electrodiagnostic tests. And this is often time dependent. In the chronicity, when the acute injury is there, these are far better. And when the chronic injury is there, then because the whole system is affected, so you cannot pinpoint whether the dorsal horn or whether the peripheral or whether the central. So the whole system, whole circuit is damaged. You cannot distinguish. So it's acute phase. It is far better rather than in the chronic phase. And these are not standardized investigation and may be modified by the practitioner. So it's a operator bias is also very common when you order the same patients at the same time with the two persons who are doing. So there may be a little bit of discrepancy in the both reports. In the summary, it is a high sensitive indicator of early nerve injuries, and it detects dynamic and functional injuries missed by MRI. It provides information regarding chronicity of the nerve injury. It provides prognostic data, and it is highly localizing. It clarifies the clinical scenario when one disorder mimics another, and it identifies combined multi-site injuries and avoids misdiagnosis. It provides longitudinal data for charting course and response to therapy, and all dependent on a reliable laboratory with the full repertoire with the technician and the doctors who is doing it. So they are useful in localizing neuromuscular disease sites and providing information about the nature of the process, whether it is demyelinating, axonal, primarily muscle, radiculopathy, plexopathy, and whatever. But it cannot directly determine the etiology. You cannot. Diabetes, Guillain-Barre syndrome, dermatomyositis, or ruptured disc, whatever it is. So the relevance of these tests to the patient pain must remain a clinical determination. So the clinical examination is the most important thing. These are just a supportive thing. Thank you.
Any questions from the audience? Thank you, Dr. Gaurav. The topic of MRI will be covered by Dr. Pankaj. He doesn't need any introduction.
So why it is important for us to know about our MRI? So as a pain physician, so whenever we send patient for MRI or the patient comes to us with the MRI, we have a report with us. But now, since we are a pain physician, now it is all our responsibility. We have to diagnose. We have to come to the final diagnosis. They'll give you diagnosis on the basis of the MRI findings. But you have to clinically and you have to come to the diagnosis. Because now, if you want to do some interventions, we have to have a clear-cut diagnosis before proceeding with the intervention. But that is why it is very, very important for us to know the MRI, how to read the MRI, some basics and then pathologies. So I'll just start with the basic, very basic about the MRIs, why it is important. So this is most commonly ordered MRI by the pain specialist. And for spine, especially for the spine, it is very, very important because it is the most sought after incision for the spine. Why it is important? Because you can see this, you can see the architecture of the disc. So for us, what is relevant? We'll be talking about what is for us, what is relevant. Now, architecture, we can see the whether this hydrated disc or it is a desiccated disc. So why it is important for us to know the hydration? If there is hydration, good hydration is there, then we can go ahead with the ozone discectomy. If the hydration is not there, then ozone is not going to work. So all these things we have to see. These things are not available, these things are in, not in the knowledge of the radiologist. So they'll give report on the basis of whatever they are seeing it. So all these things we have to see. So we'll see whether it is hydrated or desiccated disc. Is there any disruption of the end plates and annulus? Most of the times we'll see reports, they don't mention about the annular tear. So we know, as a pain specialist, we know there is a condition that is called discogenic pain. Annular tears, a high intensity zone, HIZ, that can cause pain. Annular tear can cause pain. So now we have to correlate with the clinical. Herniation. Now herniation, we have to see whether it is a contained herniation, it is an extruded herniation. They'll just mention about PAVD. At times we'll see that they'll just mention about the herniated disc. They'll not tell you about the whether it is a contained herniation, it is an extruded herniation, or it is a sequestered disc. Why it is important for us? If it is a contained herniation, we can think of some interventional procedures, interventional disc procedures. If it is extruded disc, if it is sequestered disc, obviously these are not our candidates. Yes, now we have an endoscopic discectomy. For extruded disc, we can do something. Secondary changes. Secondary changes means whenever we see, whenever a patient comes with the back pain, the first thing which comes to the mind is disc. Oh, herniation, it must be herniation. So that is not true. So we have to look for the other features, secondary features, which are associated with the disc, like modic changes, osteophyte, ligamentum ingrowing. So these are the other factors which may be contributing factors in the pain. Canal stenosis, obviously we can see the canal stenosis on the MRI. Standing MRI is very, very important nowadays for the listhesis. We have x-rays. X-rays can also detail listhesis. But if the patient comes to you with the MRI, with the almost normal MRI, and the patient is complaining of neurogenic claudication. If the patient says, I can't walk for more than 100 meters. After walking 100 meters, I'm getting numbness in my legs. So in this patient, you can send this patient for the standing MRI, and you can actually see the difference. Cyst, which can be detected, which cannot be detected on the x-rays or the CT scan most of the times. So for cyst, infection, and malignancies, MRI is the best diagnostic tool. So basically, these are our contraindications, malignancies, infections. These are to rule out our contraindications for the interventions. Okay, so basically, I'm starting with the very basic things. There are various sequences like T1, T2, STIR. STIR is basically a fat suppression sequence, and one other is a contrast enhance. We'll just talk about the T1, T2. You must have seen a film come to you with multiple images. Okay, T2, it will look hyper. Water will look hyper. So wherever there is water, it will look hyper. You can see here, CSF. So it is hyper. Fat will look hyper in both. Hyper means look white in both. Now you can see here, that's a subcutaneous fat. That's a subcutaneous fat, T1, T2, both looking white. And then bones. Bones will look hypo in both, T1 and T2. So that is the basic difference between the T1 image and the T2 images. Now you can see here, that's the bone. That's the bone here, that's the bone here. Both are looking black here on T1 and T2. So that is the basic difference. And now, at times, we need a STIR images. Because if we are not sure about whether it is a fatty infiltration or it is edema, in those cases, we have to go for the STIR images. In STIR images, what they do is that they suppress the fat. So suppose this is a condition, like here. This is white here, this is white here. Now if they are not sure about the condition, what is this? So what they'll do is they will just suppress the fat. If it is just a fatty infiltration, you can see here, STIR image, the fat is suppressed. So this is how they can differentiate whether it is a hemangioma or it is just a fatty infiltration. So this we already discussed, the fat looks white on T1 and T2. Bone marrow. You can see here, bone marrow, because this is normally fatty. So fat, we know it looks white on both, T1 and T2. So on T1 and T2, we'll see bone marrow is white. You can see here, this is T1, that's a T2. In both the things, it is white. Now we want to differentiate whether this is a bone marrow or this is something else. You can see here, in this picture and this picture. Now we are not sure whether it is a fatty infiltration, it's a bone marrow, or it is what. So again, we'll see the T1 and T2 images. Now you can see here, on T1, it is looking dark. In T2, it is looking white. So what is that? That's edema. That's edema. Secondary to disc degeneration. So these are the end plate changes. So we can differentiate whether it is a fatty infiltration or it is a edema. Tumors, it is hypervascular. Around the tumors, you can see the hypervascularity is there. This is how we can detect, because this hyperpeptidic tumor edema is there. So what are the other sequences what we take? Normally we take three sequences. Normally they take two sequences, and if there is some doubt, they go for the coronal section. So that's the three sequences. This is the sagittal section, that's the axial section, and that's the coronal section. So coronal section is basically good for your, if you have a scoliotic problem, or if they want to see, look for the sacroiliac joint. For these things, usually the coronal sections are taken. Contrast enhance. Now, why it is important? At times, we have to go for the contrast enhance MRI. Especially, you must order any patient coming to you post-operative or post-intervention, for that matter. If the patient coming to you after anything, any intervention, then you must order a contrast enhanced MRI. Don't just go for the normal basic MRI, because the most common, very important cause of pain after the procedure, increase in pain, is the infection. Discitis is very, very important cause of pain, increase in pain. So must go for the contrast enhanced MRI, because initially you will not find anything. If the patient comes to you after 2 weeks, if you go for the MRI, you will not find anything. But if you have a contrast MRI, you can detect the edema. Like in this case here, there's something is here. That's a T1 image. And after contrast, you can see there is some edema there. Basically, so there is a confusion whether it is a remaining disc or it is something else. So after enhancing, we could find out there something is there. So this is what basically, this is all edema. So this could be infective also. So you can see here, there is nothing. But here you can see this after enhancement, you can see some edema there. So this could be infective, post-surgical infective. So must order contrast enhanced MRI after any intervention. Okay, now we'll just see the sagittal views. What all sections normally we take? Now you can see this sagittal means we are dividing the body into two parts. Sagittally, we are cutting body into two parts. Now here on the right side, you can see here, we are dividing it from the center. So when we cut the spine into two parts, right and left, what we'll see? Now you can see here. So that's a vertebral body. That's the intervertebral disc. And you can see there's a end of the spinal cord at the L1, L2 level. And you can see the bunches of the nerve. So these are the bunches of the nerve. So why it is bunch? Because initially all the nerve roots are in the center. So, and we have taken it from the center. So when we take it from the center, we'll see the bunches of the nerve. So it is taken like this from the center, that is why we have a bunch of the nerve. And then we'll go paracentral. When we go paracentral, now you can see the individual nerves here. Can you see this nerves? So these are the traversing nerve root. That's the traversing nerve root for this disc. That's the traversing nerve root for this disc. So if you have a central herniation, on this section we'll see the herniation there. But if you have a paracentral herniation, you will see the paracentral herniation in this section here. If this herniation is somewhere here, you will see the herniation over here. And with this, you can detect whether it is a traversing nerve root which is involved or it is an exiting nerve root which is involved. So that is why these sections are important. If you go further lateral towards the foramen, when we go towards the foramen, you can see there, that's the foramen now. So this section is taken from here. So now you can see the nerve roots here. Now you can see the nerve roots. Suppose the herniation is foraminal herniation. Herniation is over here. So what are we expecting? Now we are expecting that it is the exiting nerve which is involved. Because now for this disc, suppose if you're talking about this disc, there's a herniation here, is a foraminal herniation, the nerve which is involved is the exiting nerve root, not the traversing nerve root. So these things are very, very important for us to know. And this we'll come to know only when we see the MRI. Because they'll not write about the exiting nerve root or traversing nerve root. Most of the time. Now the scenario has changed. Now they started writing about the exiting nerve root. They started specifying the nerve roots also. But still, I have seen a lot of reports where they don't mention about the nerve root which is involved. Whether it is a central herniation, paracentral herniation, they don't even, at times, they don't even mention that. Okay, so that was the sagittal section. Similarly, we'll go to the other side also. And this is how we can see different views. Now the axial section, you can see this, that's the axial section taken from like this. Now in the axial section we'll see, since this is taken at the alpha SN level, you can see the sacrum, you can see the ileum also here, you can see the SI joint here, you can see the facet joints over here, alpha SN facet joint, that's a disc area, and these are the small nerves. You can see the nerves, bunch of the nerves, these are sacral nerves. Similarly, we'll go up. So initially what they'll do is they'll take pictures, and then where there's a pathology, they'll just concentrate on that area. They'll take four or five sections from that area. Now here you can see, you can see the nucleus pulposus, white, because that's a T2 image. Nucleus pulposus is hydrated, that is why it looks white on T2 images. You can see the annulus fibrosus, it is less hydrated, so you can see it's black, dark. That's the facet joint here, that's the spinous process, lamina, and these are the nerve roots. So suppose the herniation is somewhere here, you can detect which nerve root is involved here. Similarly, we'll go up. Similarly, in the cervical region, we can detect everything like this. You can see this, that's a spinal cord here, that's a disc, that's a C2, that is odontoid, this is the anterior tubercle, that's a posterior tubercle or T2, C1, that's an intervertebral disc, that's a CSF, that's a posterior longitudinal ligament here, and that's the epidural, that's the ligament of phloem here. Okay, I just forgot to mention about ligament of phloem here. Okay. Yeah, so these are the spinous process here, and you can see these are the interspinous ligament here, and that's the ligament of phloem. And just anterior to the ligament of phloem is what? That is the epidural space. Now, epidural space also has a fat, epidural fats. So that is why it looks white on T1 and T2 both. That's the axial view, cervical axial view. You can see that's a disc, that's a spinal cord, that's a CSF. You can see that both the nerve roots coming out like this. These are the nerve roots. That's the spinous process. That's the ligament of phloem over here. And what else? Okay, so these are the articular pillars here. Articular pillars. Standing MRI, now you can see here, that's a listhesis. Now after standing, the patient, this is lying position, supine. And this is picture taken after the standing. Yeah, of course, definitely standing MRI is not available everywhere. So you can rely very well, you can rely on the X-rays. So whenever you are suspecting listhesis, it is always better to go for the standing X-ray, flexion extension. Flexion extension will tell you about the stability. That's a high intensity zone. You can see here, that's a hydrated disc, very healthy disc. Nucleus pulposus looking white. That's alpha S1 disc looking white. That's a healthy disc. Now you can see here, it's looking slightly black. The hydration is less. So dehydration started taking place. And also you can see there's a tear. So what is that? That's a high intensity zone. So this is because of the accumulation of some inflammatory products there. It is not the nucleus pulposus which has come out. It is the accumulation, exudate, inflammatory exudate. And these are the patients who will come to you with a discogenic back pain. So I was mentioning about the secondary changes. So this is also very, very important to understand the secondary changes which are associated with disc. So we must detect these things before proceeding for the intervention. Now you can see here, that's a type 1 body changes. You can see that's T1, that's a T2 image. You can see the difference. So that is basically because of the edema, because that is water. That is why T1, it's looking black, on T2, it is looking white. So these are the patients who are going to respond interdiscal. Some studies are there where they have indicated interdiscal steroids that helps in these kind of patients, type 1 body changes. Interdiscal ozone being a very good anti-inflammatory action, it also works in this kind of patient. But if you have a patient like this, now you can see here, T1, T2, both are looking white. So these are basically, it's a fatty replacement. So in this patient, it is not interdiscal steroids or interdiscal ozone is not going to help. That's a sclerosis, looking black on both. That's a sclerotic images. So this is how we can differentiate whether it is edema, it is a fatty infiltration, or the sclerosis. Facet arthropathy is very commonly associated with disintegration, so we should also look for the facet arthropathy on MRI. Now you can see here. So what happens, whenever there is a disintegration, there is thinning of the disc, and it starts putting pressure on the facet joint. So why this is important? At times it is not a disc which is causing problem. On MRI it is looking very desiccated disc, a very thin disc, but that is not a source of the pain. It is a facet joint which is causing the pain. Now you can see here, that's a facet arthropathy. Now again, we have to differentiate because our treatment plan depends on the which type of arthropathy is this. So it is us, we have to differentiate whether it is an inflammatory arthropathy or it is a degenerative arthropathy. Now in MRI you can see here, there's a fluid here in the facet joint. So this is most likely, this is a inflammatory arthropathy. You can see here in the same patient, you have a degenerative type of arthropathy. So obviously in degenerative type of arthropathy, facet arthropathy, you cannot go intra-articular. Even if you're able to reach the intra-articular, there's no role of steroids here. So you have to go for the median branch block. But if you have a picture like this, there's no need to go for the median branch block or the RF fibrillation. Just simple intra-articular injection will help. So we must understand what type of pathology is this. Ligamentum buckling, so whenever there is a thinning of the disc, it starts putting pressure on the posterior segments, and you can see that's a ligamentum flavum. So you'll see that most of the time it is written that ligamentum flavum hypertrophy. But actually ligamentum never hypertrophies. None of the ligament hypertrophies. It is basically the buckling of the ligamentum inside, because it started putting pressure on the posterior segment. When it starts putting pressure, you can see it's buckling inside. Now in this picture you can see here, there's hardly any herniation. There's a big buckling over here. So it is the ligamentum flavum which is compressing the nerve root. It is not a disc. Even if you decompress this disc very beautifully, patient may not have very good pain relief, because it is ligamentum flavum which is more compressing the nerve root. So that is why we must understand all these things. Okay. Herniation, which type of herniation is this? Whether it is central herniation, paracentral, foraminal, extraforaminal. Because our treatment plan depends on whether it is an exiting nerve root or it is a traversing nerve root which is involved. Whether it is a contained herniation or excluded herniation. Contained herniation, you will see the base is always bigger than the height of the herniation. Whereas you can see here, that's excluded disc. The base is very, very small. So these are the patients who are not going to respond to our intervention procedures. Especially, and now since we have started doing endoscopic discectomy for excluded disc also, so in these are the patients where we have to go for the annulus also cutting to take out the nucleus material from the herniated part. Sequestrated disc, you can see here, the sequestrated material is lying somewhere else. Now it has come out, it is lying somewhere else. It may migrate caudally, or it may migrate cranially also. Discitis, must suspect if the patient comes to you after any intervention or after any surgery. So you can see here, we can not differentiate between T1 and T2 here, whether it is discitis. Now you can see here, that is a contrast, post contrast. You can see a lot of edema there. Lot of collection is also there in the disc. So that is why the importance of sending this patient for the contrast MRI after any intervention. So that's the normal fanning of the nerve roots, which we see. Again, after intervention, patient coming to you with a severe pain in both the legs. One other complication which is there is arachnoiditis. This is how it looks like, arachnoiditis. You can see there's a bunching of the nerves. So normally what happens, when we go paracentral, you'll see the fanning of the nerve roots coming out. But in these cases, we'll see that it's still bunching. They stick together. So that is how we can detect the arachnoiditis. Okay, so that is what I have covered about the MRI basics. I think this is clear to all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Pankaj.
Thank you.
Any questions from the audience, please?
Any question from the audience?
Okay, so now we will start our panel discussion, which is on the diagnostic dilemma. So we just covered two cases. So we'll start the panel discussion. Okay. So normally what we see whenever we receive any investigation report, especially the CT scan, MRI, or the X-ray report, we always see that it is written at the bottom, please correlate clinically. So what does that mean? We are sending patient to, with the expectation that we'll get some diagnosis. But they send a patient back to us with this line written. So is this this line they're writing to protect themselves medically, legally, or they don't want to conclusively comment on the MRIs or the CT scan or the X-rays? So what is the importance of this line? Please correlate clinically. May I ask Dr. Arif,
yes,
what is the importance of this line?
The first thing is they want to be safe from the medico-legal aspects. And second thing for us, that it is said that we should not treat an MRI or any investigation, we should treat the patient.
Yes.
So your clinical skill is very important. And with what idea you are sending the patient. It doesn't mean that, I will give a simple example, like a patient of around middle age, he has a back pain or any kind of pain, radiculopathy, and you are sending this patient for an MRI, and the diagnosis of the MRI is that patient has a PIVD. So if you see, it is said that around 40 to 50% of the population in that age group will have these kind of findings, which may be normal. So it is said they are abnormally normal for that age group. So it is very important that we have to correlate. So first, that we have to rely on our clinical skills, and then we can say that these investigations either supplement or complement our diagnosis.
Yes.
Yeah. That is
okay. So at times we have seen that we send a patient for MRI and whatever investigation, and we don't find anything. They write just right, don't use normal MRI. But when the patient comes to us, we see that there is something abnormal is there. So in those cases, what is your practice? What do you do?
So
when you have suspicion, you can read MRI, you have some suspicion. Can you send these patients back to the radiologist?
No, it is better to review the MRI from another clinician, because after all, he is a human being. He might have missed something. So if you are sure about your diagnosis, you discuss with your patient, as you have rightly said in one of your case presentation, that
yes.
A person who has come from US and everybody was treating his MRI. The patient has a SI. So explain the patient what is the problem. I will see the same thing two months back, one of the gynecologists sent a patient to me that this patient, she has a back pain, because most of the time the female in younger age group, after having their child, means around 35, they have completed their family, they attribute their back pain that most of the time they have a gynecological cause, which is not the truth. So that gynecologist, she was telling that gynecologist, I want hysterectomy. So he sent this patient to me, just have a review of the patient, where all investigations were normal. His MRI was done, his CT, this X-ray was done, and clinical examination, he was seen by an orthopedician. So everything was normal. But what was my clinical suspicious was that patient has a facet joint arthropathy, a typical feature. So I told the patient that here comes the role of your diagnostic procedures, which has some intervention, have some diagnostic values also, so which are very simple. So I am telling this I explained to the patient that what is your problem, your
we'll
investigations, even the MRI doesn't show any changes in facets.
We'll come to the diagnostic later.
So my experience is that review the patient,
yes,
explain to the patient what is
yes.
his problem, and then use your clinical system. And if you have any difficulty, what we have said, that a multidisciplinary approach, which is very
exactly.
important in the pain
exactly.
management. If
exactly.
you are not, you feel that you are not able to diagnose, call your friend, call your some
exactly.
other colleague, he will help
it is,
you.
It is always better to consult with a radiologist who is
another
reporting the MRI or the CT scan, whatever.
Another
if you have suspicion, it is always better to call this radiologist and discuss with the
yes.
case. There's no point of hesitating this thing.
Like,
or have
let's, see, let's see if
yeah.
this patient has come primarily to you.
Yes.
You examined the patient, but even then you will get an MRI done. MRI, we have to exclude the red flag signs also. In an old age patient, might be some malignancies.
Yeah, we'll come to that.
But after seeing the MRI, you are not looking for the disc because that's not the area where the patient has got the symptoms.
Dr. Pankaj, another important thing is that we send blank forms to the MRI. The doctor there
about the symptoms. Very, very important part, yes. It is always better to write some clinical note and send a patient for MRI.
If they are clinically, because you have not given him or her a clinical scenario of the patient.
That is very, very important point, yes. So my next question to Dr. Kritika, so what are the relevant investigation? Because most of the patients to the pain specialists who are coming are chronic pain patients, widespread pain, with some pain syndromes. So can we just go ahead with the investigation, starting from the lab investigation to X-ray, to CT, to MRI, to PET scan? Because most of the chronic pain patients, neuropathic pain patients, we not find any abnormality in those patients. So there has to be some limit. So where will you go? What are the relevant investigations?
The difference between acute and chronic pain is in acute pain, we order investigations to confirm the diagnosis. Supposing appendicitis, ultrasound, or something will confirm lab investigation. But in chronic pain, there is no way to confirm our diagnosis. The investigations only help us guide towards a confirmation. So if you are suspecting a discogenic pain, probably you will order an MRI. But if the patient has widespread pain, something say like fibromyalgia, what you are suspecting, then there is nothing that will tell us for sure that this is fibromyalgia. So you order the relevant investigation. You don't need to order a whole battery of investigations.
Yeah,
and as per these pain syndromes or widespread pains are there, by the time they land up in our clinics, they have been already investigated. So most of these pain syndromes are the diagnosis of exclusion of other diseases.
But so now, by the but now as gradually our field is advancing, the pain specialists have started taking. So I think now most lot of patients, like I think in my practice, or Dr. Jain is sitting here. Sir, I think now most of the patients are coming directly to us. Those are the days when we used to see patients coming with the bulk of the bunches of the papers and the MRIs and the CT scan. But nowadays, a lot of patients are coming directly to pain specialists. So it is we have to order.
So one of
if there is this patient which you showed, the first patient whom you were suspecting SI joint, you can send the patient back to the radiologist and ask for a few CT cuts because bone is seen better on CT.
Yeah.
So depending upon what you're suspecting, whether facet or
Absolutely.
SIJ
Absolutely.
Or hip joint, we can ask for
So one of the important aspect of the pain management is definitely that we have to limit the resources, the burden on the resources. That is important idea. If a patient of pain syndrome comes to a fibromyalgia, by the time she comes to you, she will have a big file of all the investigations. And if you are going to repeat the same investigations,
Absolutely.
So it will be, because what now the question is asked us by other specialties that what is special about pain management? What you people are doing? If you see the one of the important concept or aspect of the pain management is that the less utilization of the health resources, that the burden should be less on the community, on the country, or on the
that
society.
Is, yes.
That is our idea.
So we have to rely on the clinical diagnosis also.
Yes.
Sir.
In my cases, let me explain how do I do it, and I think probably that will go good for everybody. Then when I have a patient who has come to my OPD and I do suspect few things, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I write on my paper and send an investigation like an MRI I'm talking right now to the MRI center. Now once the MRI is done, the radiologist talks to me before the patient is sent back home. Now this is important what I'm saying. But suppose I suspect something different or something, they take extra slices, what you said, that's why I come and intervene. And extra slices, probably some patient there we find that there is a circularization, partial circularization. We're talking about Bartolotti syndrome. So they do an X-ray there and then, although initially I may not have ordered, but if they suspected it, they're going to do an X-ray or maybe some CT slicing also for some patient who has got like fracture patient. They might do some slicing, they suspect some pedicle injury or something more. Or if patient is showing some like infective signs or some malignancy, they might go in for contrast. So the patient doesn't leave the radiology center or the diagnostic center until unless I'm convinced that I've got what I wanted from the very center. So this is very important. Patient keeps coming up and down is not good. So you have an understanding with the radiologist. Now my radiologist, if he finds something special, he's going to talk to me, only then going to send the patient back home. That understanding has to be developed because ultimately what we are going to do, not just an MRI. MRI is done to have a diagnosis ready where you can treat the patient accordingly. That's the whole idea behind. So this has to be understood.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
And another important thing is that you have to see the patient. Like I will say, simple, a patient of adhesive capsulitis. So it is very important that which kind of investigation you are advising. If a patient of adhesive capsulitis and you are advising him for go for an X-ray, and most of the time you will see the X-ray finding is normal. So it is better to send patient for a USG examination, some other investigation. So the relevance of the examination is very important. That which kind of
That comes in the relevant
and try to make a diagnosis and write with a question mark on your on your prescription. Nobody is going to hang us for that. So this is a question mark.
Because we are going to face this one.
So if he is writing that please correlate clinically, we can also say that please correlate by your investigation. So it will be vice versa.
Yeah, that is now it is possible because this is now relevant. What he is saying is relevant now because ultrasound is coming in a big way. Ultrasound in a diagnosis is coming in a big way. Now they have to search for the diagnosis. It is unlike MRI or the CT scan where we are taking cut sections and all these things. Now we have to search for the diagnosis. So this is point. This point is again relevant. Yeah, sir.
One small point again. I missed out and I must share it here. When I write my MRI, I write MRI lumbar spine. What I write, my prescription says MRI LS spine along with screening of whole spine, along with SI joint, along with bilateral hips. Now it may surprise many people sitting around because normally we write MRI LS spine, that's over. In my center, I get these four studies in one go under the price of one single thing. You may not charge your center, means you cannot get to pay back. But again, you get four MRIs and patient is also happy. Second is, sometime I've seen there are some proximal syringe or some proximal compression which you are missing out otherwise. So you don't miss on that, number one. You pick those things. Number two is, sometimes there is sacroiliitis. I've got some people who got an MRI LS spine, SI joint is not seen at all. So what's this? I mean, this is criminal, I call it. SI joint has to be included in the LS study. So SI joint has to be seen. And I do include bilateral hip for some reason. I've seen few AVNs over a period of practice. You may get one or two AVNs per year, which will go undiagnosed, and you're hitting your spine because there's always coincidental spine issue. So you keep treating your spine without knowing there's AVN, and you're harming this patient with steroids now. This is counterproductive. So this is to be kept in mind. And four more so important people whom I've done some procedure. I've already given some steroid to the patient. I've had one AVN in my practice, the patient whom I treated. Maybe I didn't retrospect, you know, initially that he had an AVN beforehand or not. But I had an AVN after treatment. This patient has to go for hip replacement. One patient, young man, about 35. So understand, a patient was nice enough. No blame, by the way. But it can just boomerang someday. So understand, knowing the hip also is equally important. So it comes in my scans. This is always there. So it may come sometime or other. But please understand, people who are really serious about pain practice, they should start adapting these habits of having. And it's not a full study of the hip. It's one coronal view will show us SI and hip both.
Yes. Nowadays, some radiology centers, they are coming with the low back pain protocol, where they are, what Dr. Neeraj Jain said. So they are including all these four sections. They're just doing the screening of the sections. And if they, whenever they find some pathology, they're going for the detailed study of that area. Okay. So my next question to Dr. Rajkumar. At times we have seen that we have a clear-cut diagnosis. We have a clear-cut diagnosis that yes, this is the condition. Patient is having trigeminal neuralgia, or the patient is having L5 radicular pain, or patient is having postherpetic neuralgia, or whatever. Clinical diagnosis, we are 100% sure. But still we want to go for some investigation. So are we doing this investigation to rule out our contraindications, and how ethical it is?
There are all the criteria are laid back. For trigeminal neuralgia, there is a guideline that we have to do an MRI. It's not that for the diagnosis purpose, it's to exclude that something is lying over there. Only last week only, I did a RFO patient. He had a small meningioma of the fifth nerve. The neurosurgeon said that this will resolve with the gamma knife. But now because the patient is having severe pain of V3, you do the RF. By that time, the effect of the gamma knife will come. She'll get relief with the RF, and then later on this tumor will go off with the gamma knife. So these are not something we are doing overactive or which are not indicated. They are very much indicated.
Yes.
So these should, is nothing wrong with doing an MRI wherever indicated, or other investigation wherever indicated.
Yes. So because in India, I think the another important issue is infection. Tuberculosis is very, very important cause of spine-related pain.
The procedures about tuberoplasty, when we are going to do the for contraindication, we are needed MRI, whether there is any malignancy or secondaries in the vertebra. So we can do investigation for the contraindication.
Sometimes we may have to do some blood tests before doing a procedure. So you're doing a cervical epidural steroid. We need a CBC and urine routine to rule out any focus of infection. You just mentioned infections.
For any kind of for any kind of interventions, we have to rule out certain contraindication.
Yes.
Any infection or then bleeding disorders, then the pregnancy, then it has been said like ozone nucleosis, let patients parathormone level or para hyperthyroidism, those has to be ruled out. It should be a protocol. I can't say protocol, it should be, it is a must that we be on the safer side. These are
even as a guide to our coming therapy, we must do the KFT, the LFT, and must do ask for history of ISHD if you're going to exhibit COX inhibitors. So that the test,
but the question comes here is, are we doing all these tests for all the surgical patient? If the patient has to undergo some minor surgery, are we going for all these tests in these patients also? Why only for the interventions? We want to go for all these tests. There are chances of infection in the surgical patients also.
No. If you go by the guidelines, even if you're giving local anesthesia for a small surgery, you are supposed to have baseline investigations.
Is it? I don't think it's there for
as anesthetist. When we used to do, when I started my practice, MTPs, we didn't have hemoglobin or anything.
For
but
MTP,
now without HB.
Yes, for MTP, yes, definitely, because there are chances of good bleeding also there.
Any but patient, basic investigations are needed. I think ASA guidelines say that basic investigations are needed.
Basic investigations are needed, but if you see this is doesn't come into the surgical intervention, surgical procedures.
Quiet profile, basic. Yeah. If you're going to put a needle below the skin, I think we must do a platelet count and a INR.
If you see the ASA guidelines also, they don't recommend for minor surgical procedure. Don't recommend PT INR or the coagulation profile.
No, since.
Yo, that is different. That is absolutely yes. If we have a contraindications,
sir.
If we have in front of contraindications, yes, definitely we have to go for
having a discussion, and we have patients going to quacks. I think in the morning people were mentioning, people take all kinds of drugs. There are a lot of these herbal and other drugs which can affect the coagulation profile.
Yes.
So we should, as a protocol, do INR for all patients before putting in a needle. And I think in corporate hospitals, viral markers are absolutely essential before you take the patient anywhere in the OT.
Yep.
Yes, but when we are going for ciliary plexus block, we need PTPC and INR. That's true. We need.
I had a very interesting case, low backache, you know, pancreas, CA pancreas, and his old MRI. And me and Mayank, we examined him, and consistently we're getting facet syndrome. But the oncologist is saying, no, you give him ciliary plexus. Ultimately, we gave him a facet block, and he recovered from it.
And one of the important is, if the patient has this frozen shoulder, if you simple, you are suspect, you want that he needs some kind of steroid shot, and you are asking patient to go for, because it is seen is very common in diabetic patients. And most of the time, if I will say I have diagnosed two or three diabetic patients just having their HbA1c and the blood sugar, because they were saying that they have some minor trauma, and after that they have all kind of feature that stage one, stage two, now it is completely frozen, they are not able to move. And so sometimes these things in mind are these simpler investigations which are not so expensive, which are not so invasive,
absolutely
will definitely going to help the patient.
Absolutely. But here we were talking about to diagnose the condition, because now we shifted towards the intervention. We are talking about to diagnose the condition. Even if you have a clear-cut diagnosis, we want to go for some investigation in certain cases to rule out contraindications.
Always we have to keep safety in mind. For
safety,
definitely. We need to have certain standardized, since we are now devising our own protocols.
Absolutely.
We should give the message that certain basic investigations should be there.
Okay.
So
you think basic investigation should be ordered in all the cases? Whether
HB,
we are doing
CBC, urine.
It depends upon the procedure.
Yes.
No.
No, no, some procedures.
Even for gadolinium, I think we must do a KFT, and of course for a contrast CT scans.
So contrast for intervention procedure, what we are contrast using is just 1 to 2 ml, maximum
still
3 ml.
But still, the implications are we may be may not be harming him, but then if he goes for a damage, he will always in retrospect rope us in.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
We have to do this, that, the thing before the procedure. So it's a must protocol. So you can, there is no chance to, from this streamline to outside, I think. So
for all the intervention procedure, so are you doing these, all the basic instruction for all the interventions? Yeah, but just for high-end procedures, yes, definitely we should go forward. But for, I don't think for the minor procedures, like for for joint injections, for transforaminals. Yeah.
No, see, you cannot predict when you will encounter a blood vessel, even if it is a small vein or an artery. All patients. I do it in all patients. All patients.
Actually, it's not recommended. Actually, it's not recommended. If we have a, some history,
There is a point of care machine available. It takes just 5 minutes, sir. You just one drop of blood.
That's okay. That's for your confidence. You can do it. But recommendations are not there. Yeah.
Dr. Pankaj, regarding the.
Yeah, Dr. Raju.
Yeah. As regards the renal profile, he said about for using the dye.
Yes.
The effect of the dye is not qualitative, it is quantitative. So 1 or 2 ml hardly is going to create any problem. So we can do away without it. Even legally, you are safe.
Yes.
99% of the time. But if you have renal disease and then you are thinking, then you should be cautious.
Obviously.
Similarly, as regards the coagulation profile, my personal belief is if the patient is on anticoagulants, you must get it done. Stop it and get it done. And if the procedure is complex, you should get it done.
Yes.
But
for a normal healthy person without any medical conditions, I don't think we should go for the coagulation profile. Maybe for basic CBC, you can go for that. But I don't think coagulation profile is required in, or LFT or KFT is required in a healthy person like 30, 40 years or 50 years.
KFT is
HIV
one
again.
One
HIV thing. Again is depends on the protocol of the center to center. Most of the surgical procedures now, most of the hospitals they are going for the HIV testing, SCV testing before taking patient inside OT. Yeah. That is again that is not mandatory. That is again not mandatory. There is a form. The legal strength behind this is you cannot force anybody to go for the HIV testing or SCV testing. If the person refuse that I don't want to undergo HIV testing, then you cannot force the patient and you cannot refuse surgery also.
Now there's another point to it, because you're using mostly disposable equipment, so it saves you, number one. About the KFT, it's not because of the dye thing only. KFT I would do in patients because these patients are already on a chronic analgesic NSAIDs.
Yes.
So that's the reason I would like to go for KFT, because you might have to go for NSAID in future also. You have to balance out. So that way KFT is more important, just not because of dye, for this reason as well.
Okay. So our next question is to Dr. Sahi.
Sir,
we have another tool. Pain specialist, we are lucky that we have another tool. That is a diagnostic block. So how reliable are these diagnostic blocks, firstly? And what is the medico-legal importance of these diagnostic blocks? Suppose a patient comes to you, you are suspecting, clinically you are suspecting something, and radiologically there is nothing. You go for the diagnostic block, you found that diagnostic block is positive, you go ahead with the intervention procedure. Suppose something goes wrong, anything can happen. This case goes to the court of law. So how will you defend yourself? Are these diagnostic blocks reliable? Is there any protocol to record the diagnostic blocks, the interpretation of the diagnostic block, and what is the medical legal significance of these diagnostic blocks?
Diagnostic blocks, in fact, in pain practice are the only gold standard for the tests to be done to confirm your pain syndrome.
Yes.
And diagnostic blocks are reliable as long as they are controlled, so that we must understand what control means. Control means use of agents and correlating the patient's pain relief with the duration of action of the agent, and site relief. Site relief means you may, if you, without telling the patient, if you inject a placebo in the same site or somewhere nearby, and the patient may have relief or may not have relief. So concordance of your procedure.
Yes.
As far as misadventure, I think we come back to informed consent. And in fact, in our institution, our seniors are very emphatic that you put the patient off all painkillers, off patches. Once he's in maximum pain intensity, then you take him to the procedure room, and then you give him first a local before you give neurolysis. And then while he's on the prone position, you ask him whether he has relief, and then you go for the neurolysis. Otherwise, I don't think we can, if you have taken a good consent from the attendants also. The attendants, I had a patient whose daughter turned around and told me, if, Dr. Sir, if you had told me 1% if this could have happened, I would not have allowed you to do this. So, coming back to that question about the dye and the KFT, you have attendants like this who really go haywire after the misadventure. This is my...
Yeah. So the caution here arises, suppose you did a diagnostic block. You ask the patient on the table that whether you have a good pain relief or not. So it is you who is doing the procedure. It is you who is going to record. So is it valid, firstly? And second thing, now you want to, if you think that patient is having good pain relief, and you want to go ahead with the neurolysis or some other procedure, RF, whatever it is. Now we know that consent taken on the table is not a valid consent. So don't you think this is medico-legally, this will go against us? If you are taking anything consent for the further treatment on the table.
Abroad, the three diagnostic blocks are permitted before they go for the permanent procedure, and there is enough coding for that. So. Okay, let me complete.
Yeah.
And otherwise, I think the consent is taken well before, and it is more than the patient, the family must be involved in taking an informed consent.
Because the interpretation will be given by the patient only. Yeah, Dr. Rajiv.
What I want to say is, it is not like angiography, angioplasty. You don't have to do it on table. And anyway, suppose you are going to do RF, if you do give local first, you can't do RF at that sitting.
Yes.
You have to do it a day after.
Yes.
So anyway, we are going to give a 24 hours window in which patient decides whether this is really helpful to
him.
And the relatives also get convinced.
Yes.
And if they give consent, then you go ahead. That will be the standard.
So it is never done on the table. Because when we, suppose the recommendations are to give two type of local anesthetic. Do two blocks with two different type of anesthetic, like xylocaine and sensoricaine. So you have to see how long the pain relief was there. So we cannot do it on the table. So we have to wait for some time. Maybe, yeah.
I was talking about cancer pain.
Okay.
And in between, we do the dye spread test, and then we go for neurolysis.
But even for neurolysis also, is it recommended that you can go ahead with the same this thing? Because for every diagnostic block, you have to give some time.
Persistence of dye shadow after giving a time period, I think you can go safely for chemical neurolysis.
Okay. Anything you want, anything, anybody of you want to add some? Yeah, please, please, please go ahead. Please introduce yourself.
My name is Nabil. I'm a neurologist. I'm from Palestine.
Okay.
I want to ask about trigeminal neuralgia.
Yeah.
Many patients present with signs and symptoms of trigeminal neuralgia. Later on, we discovered to have multiple sclerosis. So we have idiopathic trigeminal neuralgia and secondary trigeminal neuralgia. Is the treatment?
Bring it close. Bring it close. Yeah.
Is the treatment for block the same for idiopathic trigeminal neuralgia and for the secondary trigeminal neuralgia? The block for both is the same.
I think,
and who benefit from?
I think this is not relevant to our distinct topic. We have another session on trigeminal neuralgia, so you can ask this question there. So this is related to interstitials. So we'll discuss this. Don't worry, we'll discuss it during trigeminal neuralgia presentation. Yeah, any question related? Yeah, yes.
I am Dr. Munir Zaman, assistant professor, PMR physician from Bangladesh.
Bring it close.
Actually, yeah. We are discussing about the mechanical back pain, but for the, because the patient come.
She's a flight, she's getting late.
Oh, okay. You want to leave? Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Zaman.
Okay.
Thank you.
Patient usually come to you, a lot of type of, like the mechanical, inflammatory, or a lot of cases you discussed. But I think that the inflammatory back pain is missing in the topics. So if a young patient come with the diffuse pain, inflammatory natures, some investigation also need to be done to exclude the, whether it's mechanical or inflammatory. So this message should be delivered to the audience.
Yes, definitely. So
this is the message. Thank you.
So with that, we'll come to the last question. That it's a burning topic which is coming up nowadays, ultrasound. Can ultrasound replace MRI for musculoskeletal disorders? Musculoskeletal, because we have seen that early changes are not detected on MRI, but ultrasound people say that they can detect early changes. So Dr. Kritika, you have some experience about ultrasound, and can you just throw light, because is it possible?
See, ultrasound is very operator dependent.
Yes.
To get a good diagnosis, you need a person who's very good at ultrasound, and especially musculoskeletal ultrasound is again a subspecialty in radiology. So there are not many people who are good with musculoskeletal ultrasound. That is one.
So can we take over as a
MRI as yet is?
Can we take an ultrasound machine and we can start diagnosing the condition also before treating?
No.
Because we know where is the source of pain.
You can.
Yes, definitely. Training is important.
You have to be trained like a radiologist.
Training is important. Yes.
But at the same time, a lot of conditions may have a similar clinical presentation, and you should be able to look at the other places also. But if it is shoulder or something, definitely you can do it. Definitely.
Yeah. Very big advantage is a dynamic study. Sir, would you like to throw some on, can it replace to diagnose musculoskeletal ultrasound condition? Yes.
Actually, I will not like the place word replace. I should prefer the term the ultrasound will be complementing MRI. Means there are certain areas where the ultrasound should be adding the value. Mm-hmm. Say, for example, impingement.
Yes.
We cannot see the dynamic MRI. But with the USG, we can have the dynamic, we can move it, and we can see where it is impinging. MRI has, we cannot. But again, MRI has the precise, the anatomical structures can be seen by the MRI. So, in my opinion, it's not that the ultrasound will be replacing, but will be telling that ultrasound will be the filling the gaps where the MRI has the limitations.
Yes.
Also, we can give contrast in MRI, which will show us some more extra things which we may not be able to pick up in ultrasound.
Yes.
I am practicing actually the diagnostic musculoskeletal ultrasound also. So I have experience. Actually, ultrasound is the cheaper. And if the operator is expert, so you can avoid a lot of MRI in the respective joints, like the knee joints. You can see the bursa, suprapatellar pouch, rectus femoris, vastus medialis, lateralis, medial caudal ligaments, lateral caudal ligaments, meniscus, anterior horn, posterior horn, pedal ligaments, and space and ascending complex, etc., etc. But the limitation of the ultrasound is the ACL, PCL, and the whole meniscus. If you think the anterior dot test is positive, you can go direct MRI rather than the ultrasound. But if you think the MCL or LCL, lateral caudal ligament, medial caudal ligament injured, valgus valgus test positive, you can do the real-time ultrasonogram, and the by the ultrasonogram, you can trace the whole length, the MCL or LCL, or the MRI is the cut section.
Can you see the infrapatellar nerve? An infrapatellar nerve or the adductor canal?
No, no. Infrapatellar nerve can be seen. But the infrapatellar bursa we see.
Limitations will be there, yes, definitely.
Bursa we can see.
Okay, with that, just before...
No, I think everything will have its own limitations and benefits.
Yes, definitely.
So as sir, he said, complimentary. Yes. One thing I just, he said about dynamic, and it just reminded me about one of your slides. You were talking about standing MRI.
Yes, yes.
Right? Yeah. So you miss out on the MRI, which is normal sleeping MRI.
Yes.
And if you do standing,
yeah.
There is another thing which is now in vogue is stress MRI. What they do is they make the patient sleeping, and they tie a belt at the foot and the waist, and they try to compress.
Okay.
They believe that the kind of pressure it gives to the spine is as good as if the patient was standing.
Okay.
So that stress MRI gives X, and I have one patient whom I could find only on stress MRI.
Okay. So before we close this session, I just have a few announcement. So we have award ceremony today at 6 p.m. So it will be here in the hall only. So please go and tell your friends also to be there for the award ceremony. Followed by, we have a gala dinner here. And tomorrow morning, we have one holistic pain management program. It's a lecture by Johnson & Johnson at 8:15 p.m.
It's not lecture, it's a panel discussion.
It's a panel discussion.
By Johnson & Johnson,
yeah.
Where the participants, the faculties will be Dr. G.P. Dureja, myself, Dr. Susan Bhatnagar, and Ashok Saxena. So that will be starting at 8:15. And today, the award ceremony, there will be cultural program as well. So award ceremony and cultural program and the banquet dinner together. Starting at 6, here only.
Yeah. So with that, we end this panel discussion and complete session. I thank all of you, all the panelists and the chairpersons. That was a wonderful discussion. Thank you very much. Thank you, audience. Thank you.
Glove or radio protective glove, they simply can see your own digit bone, and then after long term, I think believe they will actually harm ourselves. And a lot of time patients get a lot of radiation because we continue shooting and shooting, forgetting things that is simple, you know, just shoot. Ultimately you go and check the film, he maybe go beyond 20-30 just for one block. So I strongly believe the ultrasound is the future, but it's not for every procedure.
So thank you, Toto, for your genuine comment, sincere comment. So anybody would like to add on something before we conclude this section on the lectures, before we start for the panel discussion? Dr. Tini? Dr. Matthew?
I think it's enough, but maybe for the conclusion is that ultrasound or fluoroscopy is depend on the man behind the gun, and both of them can be used in the intervention pain management, but maybe just like Dr. Das say that ultrasound can be fill the disadvantages or from fluoroscopy and the opposite. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Dini, for your comments. Anything from Dr. Matthew? Okay, any comments from the floor? Yeah, please the mic. That one nobody knows yet because there's not enough publication and research are showing. There are quite a few reports. Yes. That one I cannot tell you right now. We don't have any. Anyone from the floor would like to add on this? whether the 3D ultrasound or magnetic ultrasound would improve the performance and efficacy of block. It's coming. Yep, that's the future. Yeah, that's the future for ultrasound in the pain management. But right now, I don't have any data to share with you all because I wouldn't say it's from my experience, from what I learned in overseas lecture. No, I wouldn't say that because there's no inadequate data to substantiate the performance and efficacy of this mortality. So we are running short and late about for time. So if that's the case, we conclude the lecture section and we thank you everyone here with the claps. Okay. So the next section, I will be the moderator for a panel discussion: ultrasound and fluoroscopy in pain intervention, which and where. Okay. First of all, I would like to invite Dr. Jilafat Dalimunti to come to the stage. Okay. Dr. Jilafat is actually a consultant anesthesiologist and pain physician from Mitra Kemayoran Hospital, Indonesia. He is practicing both anesthesiology and also pain management. So he will be one of our panelists for the discussion later on. Next, I would like to invite Dr. Carlos Colela. Dr. Carlos is an anesthesiologist and pain physician as well from Hospital Queen Mary's, Portugal, long way travel here. We are very deeply honored that we have both a distinguished specialist consultant in pain and also anesthesiology to join us. May I know, is Dr. Ravi Kalatu around here? Dr. Ravi Krishna? Okay. Dr. Murali Baruma from Malaysia has left Kolkata yesterday night. So perhaps we should add one more consultant to be top here to discuss. Is it all right, Dr. Hesham Elazadi? You will come out here and sit in the panel. So to make the forum adequate. So before the panel discussion is going to start, I would like to say we are discussing about ultrasound and fluoroscopy. So it's purely opinion on your practice and also sharing experience. So that means there's no absolutely right or wrong answer. You just share your experience, express your opinion to the floor, okay? And there shouldn't be any intense argument, okay? We are just sharing opinion. Is it all right? Okay. So in order to make the discussion smoother, I will start with some questions and then each of you share your view upon the questions. As ultrasound is emerging as an important tool, both diagnostic and therapeutic in pain management, of course in regional anesthesia is already very important gold standard, but now it's emerging in pain management for all those injection and also for radio frequency, some procedure has been done. So for consultants, would you say ultrasound is a must in pain practice? Can you run a pain clinic without an ultrasound machine? We start off with Dr. Jilafat. What do you think? You just express your opinion. Can you run a pain clinic without an ultrasound machine?
Well, I guess as my experience doing pain practice in these last 5 years, I think in the beginning, I only learned SIOM, okay? I was reading from textbook. There's lots of techniques that could doing in pain treatment. But in these last 2 years, I saw there is some magic in ultrasound. I can say there is some magic because besides of the benefit of the ultrasound itself, I think it is very easy to tolerate. But the key is, I think how to operate the ultrasound correctly. This very important things because that our practice room, that is only two person, doctors and patients. The patient will not know what doctors examine, So if we want to try to lie ourselves, it means we will have making a mistake. So that it means to me myself, I prefer ultrasound for my pain practice.
So you would prefer to have one in your clinic?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you for your opinion. How about Dr. Carlos? What do you think?
First, one comment. My colleagues forgot the cranium. Trigeminal ganglion is sphenopalatine ganglion. You forgot. I prefer the two devices. I use ultrasound daily in acute pain in orthopedic anesthesia. Is the must, the rabbit. But I think in my hospital, for lumbar spinal block, is very difficult, dangerous, not only in obesity, not only. In dry people, old people, is very difficult. The needles aren't so good to make a good visualization. You can inject high contrast. I think is dangerous to make with ultrasound lumbar spinal blocks. Facets or medial branch is it. In cervical spine, you can use both. For all blocks and musculoskeletal, suprascapular, brachial plexus, sciatic, abdominal blocks like celiac vex block or epigastric, ultrasound is better. I think is better. But I prefer F2.
So you would like to keep your fluoroscopy in your pocket at the same time use an ultrasound. What about Professor Hisham from Egypt?
For me, I agree with you about that both devices are very important. And there is another thing is important, that the practitioner should use the device which has a familiar with. So this is the first, because most of us start to practice pain with CR, most of us. And if you think about, I will do like Budendal, or I do, it is easier for me to start with CR. But we should learn ultrasound, because sometimes it give good opportunity and give good chance to do very simple without radiations, without high cost, very simple. So both devices are very important. I don't think that lion will eat the rabbit or the rabbit will eat the lion. No, I think both of them will stay and live together.
Happily maybe, forever.
Maybe later on, after the advance of 3D ultrasound or something like that, someone will disappear, of course, maybe.
Okay, good. Thanks for sharing. So just add on to the question just now, whether is it a must for ultrasound in a pain practice in a clinic setting.